Okay, so let's first discuss what is instantaneous. Center of rotation. Okay, so so what is, let's say, how are we going to define the instantaneous center of rotation? Okay. So first of all, for can be defined, let's say, for a rigid body in plane motion, there exists a point on the rigid body where the instantaneous velocity zero, right? So this is basically the definition of instantaneous center of rotation, right? So let's say in very simple words, what it is trying to convey, it is just trying to convey, let's say if I have a rigid body called as A, right? Then let's say if I have another rigid body, right, which is called as B, right? So for some time, let us assume that this rigid body B, it is fixed, right? So it cannot be fixed, right? Or it may be fixed. But let's say in this case, I'm assuming that the rigid body is fixed and the body A, this body A, it is moving relative to this fixed body B. So what will happen? The definition of this instantaneous center of rotation, it states that it might happen, let's say there exists a point P, there exists a point P somewhere on this body A where the instantaneous velocity reduces to zero, right? So this is simply saying that if this is the situation, then what will happen? Then this P, it is called as, okay, so let me write down in short form, just I center, right? So then this P, it will represent the instantaneous center of rotation for this body A, which is having relative motion with respect to this fixed body B, right? So now let us try to explore this thing further, right? Okay, so now let us try to understand this thing, right? So let me again draw this. Now let us say again, we have two bodies, right? So let's say this is your body A. And again, let's say this is your body B. Right? Now what you do, let us take two points on this body A. So you just remember, right now I'm just considering that this body A, it is having relative motion with respect to body B, right? So now let us remove this assumption that this body B is fixed, right? Now I'm not going to that. So I'm now just saying that this body B, it is also moving, the body A is also moving. But again, just remember this word, that this body A is moving relative to this body B. That means we are studying the motion of this body B A with respect to this body B. Right? Now, let us consider two points on this body A. Let us consider two points P, and then let's say consider another point Q, right? So let us consider these two points on this body A. Now, if we observe the linear velocity of these two points, right? So let us say the linear velocity of this point P, it will be something like this, Vp, and the linear velocity of this point Q, it will be something like this, Vq, right? So now just remember that what we did, we just draw the velocity vectors for this points P and Q, right? So obviously this body A, it is rotating relative to, or it is moving relative to this body B. So that's why this P and Q points on this body A, they will have certain velocities. So let us say this Vp comma Vq, right? Velocities of points P and Q on body A, right? Now what you do, now you just draw in the next step, you simply draw lines perpendicular to this Vp and Vq, right? So you will come to know like what I am trying to convey. So now next, what we are doing, we are just drawing lines perpendicular to this Vp and then perpendicular to this Vq. Right. Now these two lines, they intersect at this particular point. So now let us call this point as I. Right. Now the two lines, right, or you can say the two perpendicular lines intersect at I. Now a very important thing I'm going to mention, just try to focus here. So for a particular instant, right, for a particular instant, right, when the velocity of these two points P and Q are Vp and Vq, right, it can be imagined, it can be imagined that the body A is rotating about the center I, right? So this point I, this is basically called as instantaneous center of rotation or body A, right? Moving relative to body B, correct? So see, this is a very important thing. Now, if we observe this motion very carefully, right? If we observe this thing very carefully, right? So we can simply imagine that at this particular instant, when the velocity of points P and Q are Vp and Vq, we can imagine this whole body A, it is trying to rotate about this point I. So if you just clearly visualize this, that this whole body A, right, this is trying to turn itself about this point A, right? So in, about this point I. So now this point I, it is called as instantaneous center of rotation for body A moving relative to body B, right? Now, let's go back to the original definition. So what does this say? Right. What is this? For a rigid body in plane motion, there exists a point on the rigid body where the instantaneous velocity is zero. Right. So now how can we relate this thing to this one? Can anyone just try to explain this thing? How this diagram, right, this Vp, Vq and the entire analysis which we did here, it is related to this one, right, to this definition. So can anyone just try to explain this?
So Sir,
Yeah.
if this body is moving, is rotating at point I,
Right.
with respect to point I, that the velocity of point I will be zero.
Good, very good. So, see, if you have to satisfy this definition, the only thing is that if you have to satisfy this definition, then the only possibility is that your body, it should rotate about this particular point, right? That is the instantaneous center of rotation. Then only this is possible. Otherwise, this definition, it is difficult to satisfy, right? So now the simple analogy is that at I center, right, the velocities, okay, or let's say point I common to A and B is zero. So just remember this thing, right? So now, first of all, I have written this sentence that this velocities of point I, right, common to A and B, right? So what does this mean? See, whenever you define this instantaneous center, right? So it is defined with respect to two bodies which are in relative motion. Always remember this thing. So now in many books, you will find that they simply say that, okay, the instantaneous center on this body A, right? But that is true only when this body B is fixed. So let us say if this body B is not fixed, right? It is having some relative motion, right? Then in that case, you simply say that this instantaneous center, it will be basically common to both the bodies A and B. That means if you take this instantaneous center on body A, then the velocity will be zero at this particular point. And at the same time, if you take this instantaneous center on body B, then also the velocity at this particular point will be zero, right? So this is very important. Just try to remember this thing, right? That in such cases, you will always say that this instantaneous center, it is basically common to both the bodies, because ultimately the velocity at this particular point, it is going to reduce to zero, right? So now let us again move to let us try to again further explore this, right? So let me, okay, draw a simpler diagram just to understand this. Now let me take again these two points P and Q. So now one point here I have taken Q. Right? So this is my body A, right? So this is my body A, right? And let us say this is again my body B. So now I took these points P and Q like this, right? So let's say at a particular distance, this point P, it is moving like this, right? And at another particular distance, this point Q, let's say it is having a velocity vector in this direction. Right? Okay, always try to remember that now these two points P and Q, they are the points on body A. So just don't get confused. Means you cannot say that this P and Q both are common to A and B. Right? P and Q points, they are on body A. Only the instantaneous center, it will remain common to both A and B. Always just keep this thing in mind, right? Now let us join these two points. Right? Now what I am trying to explain through this diagram, through this analysis, you will come to know that, okay, why, what I am actually trying to explain. Right? Now, let us draw the instantaneous center for these two. So see, to draw the instantaneous center, when the velocity vectors are given, you have to simply draw lines perpendicular to those two velocity vectors, and the point where these two velocity vectors intersect, that will be your instantaneous center. So now this is your point I. Fine. Now, let us call this angle as theta. And let us call this angle as phi. So this is your angle phi. Right? Now this is your velocity vector Vp. This is your velocity vector Q. Okay. Now just tell me if the distance PQ remains same, then how can we relate this Vp and Vq? Can anyone just try to explain? So what I'm just saying, see, these two points P and Q, they are two fixed points on rigid body A, correct? So that means the distance PQ, it is always going to remain the same, right? Then I'm just asking, is there any possibility to relate this Vp and Vq? Can anyone guess? So see, it's simple physics. Just try to think about this. Nothing more. It's very simple physics.
We are rotating, sir.
How can you relate this Vp and Vq? Can you give me a relation?
There will be angle difference of theta and plus phi.
Angle difference, right? Okay. See, if let's say I talk of the velocity component, right? Let us talk that the velocity component in the x direction, right? The resultant velocity in the x direction. So will it be, let's say, it will give you some value, or will it be zero?
It will give you some value.
Think about it. Resultant velocity in x direction. So I'm just talking about this, right? So just think about this. Okay, so let me again ask you in the, this question in a different way. So just tell me that velocity of this point P, that is Vp, in x direction, right? And velocity of point P, that velocity of point Q in x direction.
Right? So Vp cos theta and Vp cos Vq cos phi.
Okay, so very good, right? So now just let me just put a equality sign. So if I put this equality sign, will it be correct or not?
No, sir. So magnitude of Vp and Vq are different.
Negative of Vp and Vq.
See, magnitude of Vp and Vq.
Yeah, the magnitude, they are different, but I'm just saying, right? The both means, do you think that magnitude will be different? Think about this again. See, it's very simple. If the distance PQ, this is going to remain constant. That means the relative velocity of Q with respect to P, it is not changing. Okay. Or you can simply say that this P and Q, right? They are moving with a, this P and Q, they are moving with the same velocity, right? So you can simply say that then only this condition can be satisfied. Otherwise, this condition cannot be satisfied. So if this distance PQ, it is going to be fixed in your rigid body, right? Then it is very obvious that this P, the point P and the point Q, they will have the same velocity in this particular direction, right? So right now, I'm just calling this direction as X direction, right? So in this particular direction, they are going to have the same velocity. Then only it is possible that this distance PQ, it will remain fixed on the rigid body, right? So now we can simply write down this thing as Vp cos theta is equal to Vq cos phi, right? So now this is very simple. So we will form a relation that Vp upon cos phi is equal to Vq upon cos theta, right? So this is our first condition. Now let us move to another condition, right? Now applying triangle law, right, in triangle IPQ, right? So now what I'm trying to do, I'm just trying to apply triangle law in this triangle IPQ, right? So this angle will be your, just this is simple geometry. This will be your pi by 2 minus phi. This angle will be simply your pi by 2 minus theta, right? So this will be now simply IP, okay? So IP is this side and divided by the angle opposite to this IP. IP divided by sine pi by 2 minus phi is equal to, now take this one, IQ divided by sine pi by 2 minus theta. Okay. Now, again, simply this equation will be reduced to IP divided by cos phi is equal to IQ divided by cos theta. Now, what you do, you simply divide these two relations, right? That is 1 divided by 2. So finally, you will get something like this. So 1 simply divided by 2. So now you have VP upon IP is equal to VQ divided by IQ. So this is the final relation we got. Okay. So is there any doubt till this point? So this is very simple. So first relation, I have assumed that this distance PQ, it is going to remain same. That means the resultant velocity in this particular direction, in the direction of PQ, will be zero. So from there, I obtain this relation. Then second is very easy. Second, I just simply apply the sine law, or you can say the triangle law, right? So I just put IP divided by this angle opposite to this IP, then equal to IQ divided by the angle opposite to this IQ. And then finally, I came to this relation. And then in the end, I simply divided these two relations. Now, this is something very important relation. So just can you interpret the physical meaning of this relation? Can anyone just interpret it, this thing for me? See, so this thing we already discussed. Just try to interpret it physically. What does this relation indicate physically? So go back to this diagram. So it is what saying VP divided by IP, right? And this is VQ, this vector divided by IQ. And both these points P and Q, right? They are rotating basically about this instantaneous center of rotation, right? Or you can say the entire body A at this particular instant, it is rotating about this point I, right? So now, just tell me, what does this relation indicate? What does this physically means? Anybody?
Sir, if the distance from the instantaneous center of for P and Q are same, then their velocity will be same.
Right. And can you just tell me like what this relation is providing you? What is this? VP divided by IQ, VQ divided by IQ. Okay, so let me give you a hint. You remember this link thing, right? So I calculated this VA. This was OA. Now, can you tell me what is this giving you? VP upon IP is equal to VQ IQ. What is this parameter? So can you just remember that how did we calculated this VA? If let's say this OA, it is rotating at something like omega, at angular velocity omega. Now, just tell me, what is this relation? What is this giving you? Anybody? See, this is what, if you remember this link, we calculated the velocity VA is equal to OA into omega, right? So omega is what? VA divided by OA. So the same thing we are doing here, right? So this is nothing. This relation is simply giving you the angular velocity of body A relative to body B. That's it, right? So now you can say that at this particular instant, always remember, I'm talking about the particular instant, because this VP and VQ vector, they are going to change their directions with respect to time. So at this instant, the body is simply rotating with angular velocity omega about the I center. Right. So this is very easy. You can simply assume that at this particular instant, I can say that this body A, it is rotating with certain angular velocity relative to this, center of rotation, that is I. Okay. Now, a very important point again I'm going to make here, right? So you have to actually keep all these points in mind, because many times, like, this is very important to know, right? Just to avoid confusion. Now, what is this important point? First of all, the I center property. Just note this point. It's true only for a particular instant. Okay, so this is first point you have to remember, that it is true only for a particular instant, right? And why we call it instantaneous center? What is the reason, right? So it is called as instantaneous center because it is representing the instantaneous velocity, right? So all you can say, the motion of this body A related to this body B at a particular instant. And this instantaneous center, it is called instantaneous because it changes with the motion of body A relative to B. Or better put this point, it changes its position, right? So that means its position is not fixed, right? It is going to change with respect to time. That's why it is called as instantaneous. Another important point. So it is a basically misnomer to call this point the center of rotation, right? So this is another important point which you have to keep in mind, right? However, it is not as such very much necessary, but still, just for your understanding, keep this point in mind, that this point, though we call it instantaneous center of rotation, but it is actually a misnomer, right? So what is this misnomer? Because usually the center of rotation, right? The center of rotation, let's say a body, it is rolling over this curved path. So now we say that, okay, this is the path which is being traced by this body A, right? This curved path, right? And then the center of rotation of this body A, generally we call that, okay, this point O, this will be your center of rotation, right? So usually in physics, or let's say in general terminology, we refer to a center of rotation as the center of rotation of the path which is taken by the body. But here nothing like this is happening, right? But still we call this as center of rotation. So just remember that it is just a misnomer, right? And why? Because simply this point is not located at center of curvature, right? It is not located at center of curvature of the apparent path traversed by body related to another. Right. So these are certain few things which you have to keep into your mind, that usually it is although referred to as center of rotation, but actually it is just a misnomer, right? But still it has wide applicability in this kinematic of machine subjects, right? So now let us move further and let us try to define this for three centers of rotation, right? So like we defined this instantaneous center of rotation for two bodies, you can define this for three bodies as well, right? So there is nothing like very much different in this case, right? So you can define this thing for three bodies as well. So now let us move to this, try to understand like what is going to happen when three bodies are going to move related to each other. So now I will try to basically explain this through a very important theorem, which is basically called as Kennedy's theorem. Okay, so now we are going to consider the motion of three bodies. So now an important theorem comes into play, right? And this theorem is called as Kennedy's theorem. Now, what is this Kennedy's theorem, right? So according to this, if three planar bodies are moving relative to each other, right? Their eye centers must be collinear. So this is the Kennedy's theorem. Now let us try to understand this, right? Now let us take three bodies. This is my body one, right? Then again, this is my body two, this one, right? This is body one. Now again, let us take another body. This is my body three. Okay, so before going into this, let us stop for a few moments because I think it might be difficult for all of you to understand this. So just tell me like till now, if you have any doubt anywhere, then we will go ahead. Because this is a slightly important concept. So if you have any doubt anywhere, then just please ask. Then I will repeat the entire thing again. There is no issue. Then we will go to the next step. So any doubt? Anybody? Any doubt? Anyone having any doubt?
No, sir.
Is it clear? Like what is going on?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, then let's move ahead. Okay, so now we are talking about three bodies. Now, let's say this body three, it is for some time stationary. Let us assume that this is fixed, right? Then the body one and two, they are having a relative motion with respect to this body three, right? So the let us define the instantaneous center of for this body one relative to three is 1, 3, right? So always remember, if you go back to this diagram, right? So we defined instantaneous center for a pair of bodies, right? So now we have three bodies. That means we will have three instantaneous centers, right? So one instantaneous center will be defined between 1 and 3, right? Another will be between 2 and 3. Then another will be between 1 and 2, right? So now we will have three instantaneous centers. So first instantaneous center is, let's say 1, 3. Another instantaneous center is the instantaneous center of, let's say this body two relative to three. Then let us say that this is your 2, 3, correct? Okay, fine. Now, let us assume a point somewhere here, right? Let us assume Okay, let me write down it so that I center of one relative to three, right? I center of body one relative to three. And this is I center of two relative to three, right? Now, one, two. So this is the I center of one relative to two, right? So just remember this thing, right? So since we have three bodies, so here basically we define instantaneous center for a pair of bodies. So here will be three, there will be three instantaneous center, right? So now let us say that this instantaneous center one, two, it lies somewhere here. So this is the instantaneous center one, two, right? Now, if you observe that in these two, one, three and one, two, this notation, this numeral one is common, right? So what does this indicate? This simply indicates that this V12, right? If let me call this V12 vector, right? Now this V12, that is the point 12, it is going to rotate about this instantaneous center of rotation, that is 13, right? And again, in a similar way, this V12, it is going to turn about this instantaneous center of rotation, I center 23, right? So this is basically your V12 vector, right? So if you observe here, I have taken two vectors, that is two directions of V12 vector. So what actually I'm trying to prove? I'm trying to basically prove this theorem, right? That if three planar bodies, they are moving relative to each other, their I centers must be collinear. So we spotted, let's say I initially defined the instantaneous center of body one relative to this fixed body three will be at 13. The instantaneous I center for this body two relative to three will be at 23, right? And then let's say I assume that this instantaneous center 12, it is lying at this particular point, right? So now let me mention this thing, V12 vector, when point 12 is considered on body one, right? So let me denote this thing in this way. Now again, V12 vector two. So see this point 12, again, see, it can be considered, let's say, common to both of these bodies, one and two, because it is a instantaneous center of rotation. So I just describe to you that this instantaneous center of rotation, it is basically common to both the bodies for which it is going to be defined, right? So this is one thing, that when this point 12 is considered on body one, and the next thing is when this point 12 is considered, right, on body two, right? Then let me call this as V12 vector two, okay? Now just tell me here, is it possible to have two velocity directions at that particular point? Is it possible?
No, sir.
So now see, this is not possible to have two directions of velocity vectors at the same point, right? And always remember, I'm always saying that this point 12, it will be common to both the bodies one and two as well, right? So this is not possible to have two directions of velocity at point 12, right? So we came to this conclusion that it is not possible to have two directions of velocity. Now let us try to describe the condition when it can become possible that the velocity of this point 12, either you consider it on body one or you consider it on body two, in both the cases they will have the same directions. So let us try to come to that condition. Let us try to observe this diagram and try to figure out, right? So Okay, so let me ask you this question. So can you tell me what could be the possible situation when this V12 vector 1, right, and then V12 vector on body 2, right, they will have the same direction. So can you just see this diagram very carefully and can you just tell me what could be that condition when this can become feasible?
Sir, if 1, 3, 1, 2 and 2, 3 are collinear.
Right. So for that, what you have to do? See, very carefully if you observe the diagram, you just bring this point 1, 2. If you bring this point 1, 2 at this location, right? So now, if you bring this point 1, 2 at this location, so now what will happen? Now you can very easily guess here, right? So if you bring this point 1, 2 at this location, then you can simply define the single direction for this point 1, 2, either you take it on body 1 or you take it on body 2, right? So now, if we move this point 1, 2 on the line joining, right, 1, 3 and 2, 3, right, then V12 vector will have same direction, either you consider point 1, 2, right, on body 1 or body 2, right. So this is how we have proved the Arnold's collinearity theorem. That means this simply indicates that I centers 1, 2, right, 2, 3, and again 1, 3 must be collinear, right? So this is a very, very important theorem, right? Arnold's collinearity theorem, that if three relative bodies, always remember the first point you have to keep into mind that this collinearity theorem, it is defined for three bodies, right, not two. So it is defined for three bodies that are having relative motion with respect to each other, right? So this 1, 2, 2, 3, basically, we generally, if we fix this, let's say, body 3, right, then we call this as absolute instantaneous center. But generally, since all the bodies are in relative motion in actual situations, so all these 1, 2, 2, 3, and 1, 3, they are basically relative instantaneous center of rotation, right? So just keep this thing in mind, right? Now, this is the Kennedy theorem that we have proved. Now let us discuss about some rules to locate I centers, right? So let us discuss some rules to locate I centers in a mechanism. Okay. So first of all, for a revolute pair, the I center. Okay, so can anyone just tell me that where for a revolute pair, this I center, where it is going to lie? What will be the position of this I center? So for a revolute pair, so what is a revolute pair? When I said that one link, it is going to have a relative motion with respect to another. So let me connect two links here. This is your link one. And then this is your, let's say, link two. So this is your R pair. So R pair is nothing. It is simply a pin joint, nothing else, right? So just tell me, so where do you think this instantaneous center it is going to lie for this revolute pair?
On the pin.
Very good. So this is very obvious, right? So if you, let's say, mark a velocity point A here, or let's say if you mark a point B here, right? And if you describe the velocity vector, so this is VA vector, this is VB vector, right? So if you move either to link one or to link two, you can easily imagine that this VA vector, right? It is this point A, basically it is going to rotate about this revolute pair, about this center O, right? In a similar way, if you consider this link two as well, you will find that this VB vector at that particular instant, it is going to rotate about this center O. So now for a revolute pair, the I center lies at the center of R pair. Okay, so this is one thing. Now another rule for a prismatic pair. Now just tell me, for a prismatic or a sliding pair, right? So where this eye center would lie. So now what is a prismatic pair? See, when you have such question, simply try to draw diagrams, right? That's it. Okay, now you have this prismatic pair. Now, so let us call this as one, this as two. Now let us take two points, a point A, another point B, right? So just tell me now that where this instantaneous center is going to lie for a prismatic pair.
Between A and B.
See, what I just told you, that what you have to do in such situations. So just draw VB vector and draw VA vector, correct? So just draw VB vector and VA vector and then just draw perpendicular lines. So now just tell me. So I did everything for you. Now
there is no eye center.
So basically, you know that there is a theorem in mathematics which states that the two parallel lines, they meet at, just complete this theorem. So the two parallel lines, they meet at where? So in mathematics, you might have studied this.
Sir, infinity.
Good, very good. So now it is very simple that the two parallel lines, right? So these two perpendicular lines, parallel lines, they are going to meet at infinity. So for a prismatic pair, the eye center lies at infinity. So this is another rule, right? Just look at it. So mostly you will be using these two, but let us discuss few more things. Okay, now let's say this is a, now I'm going to discuss pure rolling contact. So see, this is going to make many things clear. So now let us say I'm going to discuss pure rolling contact. Now let us say this is my body one, right? So this is also something, some circle. So this is my body one, this is my body two, right? So pure rolling contact means that there will be no sliding, right? So many a times the people, they get confused between this rolling motion, right? And sliding motion. See, pure sliding means there will be no rolling, right? Pure rolling means there will be zero sliding. And a combination of rolling and sliding, sometimes people call this simply as rolling motion, right? So many times they don't mention specifically that it is pure rolling motion. They simply call that it is a rolling motion. So if anybody calls that it is just a rolling motion, then you have to, first question that should come to your mind, you should ask him whether it is pure rolling or it is simply a combination of rolling and sliding, right? So here it is pure rolling. There will be no sliding of this body two related to one, right? Now, in this case, just tell me where the instantaneous centers would lie. Oh, just tell me. Can anyone just describe? So, where the instantaneous...
The intersection of the tangents.
Okay, intersection of the tangents. So, how are you going to proceed for this? Again, let us take two points A and B, right? So this is very simple. So now let us take this VA vector. And again, let us take this VB vector somewhere here. Now just tell me quickly, like what is going to happen? Where this instantaneous center is going to lie?
At the point of contact.
Very good, right? So it will be at the point of contact. So simply see, we all know that this is simply a circular motion. So in any case, whatever point you take, every point it is going to turn around this point, right? So you just draw a perpendicular lines, and obviously all these perpendicular lines, which are basically perpendicular to this velocity vectors, any point you take, because this is simply a flat disk or a circular thing, right? So now they are going to intersect at this point of contact. So in this case, the eye center, it lies at the point of contact, very easy. Now, again, if you observe here, right, what is the center of rotation basically, the actual center of rotation? So the actual center of rotation of this thing, right? You can see very carefully that it will be at this particular point. So see, this is your actual center of rotation basically, right? But your instantaneous center of rotation, it is located where? It is located here, right? So that's why we call this instantaneous center of rotation as misnomer. Sometimes it is called just a misnomer, or just to represent this, okay, that the entire body is rotating at a particular point at a given instant of time, right? But usually the actual center of rotation, you can very easily guess that this is here, right? And this instantaneous center, I center, is here, somewhere here. But let us not go try to confuse this thing too much, right? So right now, for now, you can call that, okay, this is instantaneous center of rotation. Now, let us start with the four bar mechanism and try to find out the instantaneous centers for a four bar mechanism, right? So now I'm basically going to discuss how to locate the instantaneous centers for a four bar mechanism as a slider tank mechanism. After that, we will go to the velocity analysis. After that, we will think that how are we going to perform the velocity analysis, right? So first of all, step one, whenever you have some such kind of problems where you have to locate the instantaneous center, so the first step should be calculate the number of ICs, right? So first of all, calculate the number of instantaneous centers. So how many ICs are there? So how are you going to calculate? So in this case, the number of links is how much? N equal to 4. That means 4 rigid bodies are there. Fine. Now just tell me, what will be the number of instantaneous centers? Can anyone just tell me? See, keep this thing in mind. The instantaneous center is just defined for a pair of two bodies. So if 4 rigid bodies are there, then what will be the number of instantaneous centers? Can anyone just tell me?
6.
How many?
6.
6. Right. Right. So it will be 6. Very obvious. Right. So 1, 2, 2, 3, 1, 3. I will come to that. Right. So for now, we will give a simple formula for this. So we know that if something is given in pair, then the instantaneous center will be simply N equal to N minus 1 divided by 2. So this is simply permutation combination, nothing else. Right. If you remember that it is nothing, n factorial divided by n minus 2 factorial, right? So you can simply calculate as n minus 1 divided by 2. So now put the number of links as 4 minus 1 divided by 2. This is going to be equal to 6, right? Now, what is the step 2? So first of all, in the second step, right, locate the fixed I centers, right? So locate the fixed I centers, right? So now what is this fixed I center? Or you can basically call it, leave it. Fixed I center is fine. So I will come to that. Okay, so now this is my four bar link mechanism. So now this is, let's say, link number 1, then this is your link 2, link 3, link 4, right? And then let us name this links as A, B, C, D, right? Okay, so now just look here. So first of all, I said, locate the fixed centers. So what is this fixed center? Okay. So just, can anyone just explain me quickly, what is this fixed center? So fixed center means the I centers which are not going to move, right? So the I centers which are not going to move, right? So in another way, you can simply say that, first of all, locate the I centers for simply fixed link. Right. So now just tell me, where the eye centers are lying. This fixed eye centers, which eye centers you can call as fixed eye centers?
A, B, C, D.
Okay, points A, B, C, D. Okay, you are saying this. Okay, so now let us say, see, locate the eye centers for fixed length. Now, see, we always define eye centers basically for three rigid bodies or maybe for a pair of bodies. So if you observe here that this link two, it is moving related to this body one and this body one is fixed. So the first eye center, the fixed eye center will be this 1, 2, right? So now you will name this eye center as 1, 2. Now another eye center will be this one. This is also a fixed eye center, 1, 4, correct? Now, in the next step, simply what you do, locate the permanent eye centers. So see, these steps I'm just mentioning, later on it will become very easier, right? So locate the permanent eye centers. Now, what are these permanent eye centers? What are these permanent eye centers, right? See, so this permanent eye centers, they are eye centers that are changing their position, right? Their position, but their location remains same, right? So sometimes this can confuse you. So it will become more clear. So now if you see here, again, another two eye centers will be, let us say this body two, it is going to move related to this body three. So this will be another eye center. And then again, similarly, you will have this another eye center, that is 3, 4, right? This is very simple. Now, if you clearly observe, these two eye centers, 2, 3, and 3, 4, right? So first of all, let me write down this eye centers here. That is 1, 2, and 1, 4, right? These are your fixed eye centers. Now, the permanent eye centers, if you clearly observe that these two eye centers, that is 2, 3, and 3, 4, they are going to change their position, but what their location, it will remain the same. That means they will always be located at the center of this R pair, right? So they will always be located at the center of this R pair, but what is going to happen? Their position is going to change. So such eye centers are called as permanent eye centers, right? But remember, these permanent eye centers are not fixed. They are changing their position, right? But simply their location, right? Their location with respect to time, that is going to remain the same, right? So now, in this case, these two eye centers are 2, 3, and 3, 4. Now, after doing all this, we can simply club all this thing, right? So though I described you in this thing, because I just wanted to focus on this permanent and fixed eye centers, right? But now we can club all these things and we can simply say, locate the eye centers for simple pairs. So what you have to do, you simply locate the instantaneous center for all the simple pairs first, right? That means revolute pair, prismatic pair. So all these simple pairs, you locate the eye centers first. So this should be your first step, right? So that's it. So this is just a thing to actually describe you what is a fixed, what is a permanent center, right? Now coming to step three. Now discover the eye centers. You have to find out. Now, this is something very important. This is something very important. Now, what you have to do, right? Now, you just tell me what other eye centers you need to find out, right? So there were how many eye centers? 6 eye centers, correct? So 4 have been located. So 1, 2, 1, 4, 3, 4, 2, 3. So 4 eye centers have been located. Now 2 eye centers are remaining. So what are those 2 eye centers? Can anyone just tell me? What are those 2 eye centers? Means I'm simply asking, will it be 1, 4, 1, 3, or what?
1, 3, and 2, 4.
Very good. So now, how you actually see how you figure out this thing? This is very easy. One way to figure out is simply what you do. You just write the links like this: 1, 2, 3, 4. Right. So these are your four links. Now, what you do? You simply form pairs. So you simply form pairs. So I centers. So now first I center, let us say starting with 1. So it will be 1, 2, then 1, 3, correct? And then finally 1, 4, right? So 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4. Then here it will be C. Here it will be simply, just tell me. 2, 1, 2, 3, 2, 4. And then 2, 4. Right. So see, first of all, this 2, 1 and 1, 2, right? It means the same thing. Either you call it 1, 2 or 2, 1. So better remove this one also, right? So this is also not required. So it is simply 2, 3, 3, 4. Now coming to next, what will be the last instantaneous enter? Right. This one, just tell me. So it is simply C, move in sequence 3, 4, correct? So it will be simply a 3, 4. Now, once you draw this table, right? So for this, simply draw a table. Draw a table as indicated. So just remember, simply draw this table and you will figure out. Now mark all the eye centers which are, let's say, provided to you or which are already available, right? So let us mark all those eye centers. So that is 1, 2 is given. Then finally, I think 1, 4, 2, 3, 3, 4, 1, 4, 2, 3, T, 4, right? So these two we have to find out. So this is very simple, right? So even if, let's say, like when the mechanism become very much complex, then you can simply locate or you can simply discover this thing that, okay, these are the eye centers which we have to find out, right? Now, how to find out? This becomes very important. Step 4. So first of all, let us locate 1, 3. So what is the procedure to locate 1, 3? See, one way is very easy when you become an expert into this, but let me explain you a simple approach to locate this 1, 3, right? So for this, what you do, simply draw a square. Since it is four links, so what you do, you simply draw a polygon. Right. In this case, this polygon will be square because only four links are there. Right. So now just connect these points. 1, 2, 2, 3, then 1, 4, 2, 4. Right. So now what I did here, very carefully observe. So the eye centers known to us, right, or we already find out eye centers known to us are connected by solid lines. So in the first step, you do this, right? Now, what you do, you have to find out this 1, 3. So just join 1, 3 with dotted line. Right? So in the next step, join 1, 3 with dotted line. Right? Now, what you simply do, read the points around point 1, 3 on both sides. Okay. Now just tell me, if I go to this side of 1, 3, so which two eye centers are there? Points, or you can simply say here eye centers. Okay. So if I go to this side of this one, right? This line 1, 3, then how many eye centers are there? Which two eye centers are there?
1, 4, and 3, 4.
Right. So 1, 4, and 3, 4. Right. So now 1, 4, and 3, 4. Right. Now, if I go to this side, then how many eye centers are there?
1, 2, and 2.
1, 2, and 2, 3. Right. So in the end, what you have to do, simply, right, your 1, 3 will be at the intersection of lines joining 1 4 3 4 and 1 2 2 3. So this is the simplest way to actually locate your instantaneous center 1 3, right? So once you become expert, this is not required. Now how to locate 1 3? So I just said that line joining 1 4 and 3 4. So 1 4 is here, 3 4 is here, so just extend this line, right? Then the 1 2 and 2 3, right? So this is 1 2, this is 2 3, so just extend this line. So this is your instantaneous center 1 3. Very easy. Now in a similar way, just tell me quickly that how to locate this instantaneous center 3 4. I am sorry, some mistake I have done here. I think 3 4 is already known. I'm sorry, 2 4 is not known, I think, right? So 2 and 4, so for opposite links they are not known, that is 1 and 3 opposite, then 2 and 4, right? So 2 and 4 is not known to us. So how to find out this 2 and 4? Okay, so just tell me the steps quickly. How to locate the instantaneous center 2 4? So just proceed in the same way. So just tell me, what should I do first?
First draw a line from 2 to 4,
right? So draw a line joining this 2 and 4, then after that
it is the intersection of 4 1 1 2 and 2 3 3 4,
right? So now once you join 2 4 2 4, right, so just move to this side and this side. So this side, this is 1 2 1 4, this is one line, line 1, and then again on this side, or you can call this line A or B or something like that, right? So on this side what you have? 2 3 3 4, 2 3 3 4, line B. So this will be your intersection of lines A and B, right? So this is very easy. Now you can simply say that now just extend this line, this one, and then you extend this line. So this is your instantaneous center for these two pair of bodies, that is 2 and 4, right? So 2 4, right? So this is how you locate the instantaneous center. Now a very important thing, that these two instantaneous centers 1 3 and 2 4, right? Sometimes like people ask such questions, however they are not as much important, but you have to keep into mind that these two instantaneous centers, they are neither fixed. Basically we always struggle to find out these instantaneous centers, right? So other instantaneous center, they are very easy, but now these instantaneous centers which are neither fixed nor permanent, these are very important to find out, right? So this is how we locate the instantaneous center ICs, which are neither fixed nor permanent, right? So fixed and permanent I centers, they are simply easier to locate, right? So they generally, they lie at the center of revolute pair, or let's say like some prismatic pair. But here in this case, the I centers, which are neither fixed nor permanent, they are located in this way, right? So we generally struggle for these I centers. Okay, so I think for today, this much is enough. Okay, so if you have any doubt, further doubt, then just please ask, like somewhere in this process. So just if you remember just these two steps, everything becomes easier, right? So you have to simply just remember these two steps. Any doubt? So shall I end the meeting? Yeah, anyone?
No, sir.
Okay, then thank you. Thank you, all of you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.